We're waiting for one more, so. Well, good morning. I hope you can feel the enthusiasm and optimism. We are still 34 strong. We went through a special election to keep the majority. We're very excited about that. It's a new opportunity. We have a new governor. We have a new House leadership. But we're still the same. You know what we're going to be like. We're consistent. We tell you what we're going to do, and then we do it. A couple of years ago, we rolled out Advance Minnesota. We did that in February, where we told you some of the key things we were going to work on. Today, we're going to talk about the first five bills. It's not the only bills that we're going to be doing, but it tells you what we're emphasizing early. And that came from a lot of work throughout the summer and through the fall and into just up into session, listening to what people care about out there. And that is why we started a new committee. It's called Family Care and Aging. It deals with a lot of the issues related to what's going on in families. We have a lot of families where they have aging parents or they still have kids at home, and it creates all kinds of pressures. And we know that there are real issues that we want to address, and so that's part of what's going to be reflected in this first five bills. And so first five, as you've got reached out there, we're going to deal with some mental health issues. We're going to deal with things related to child care, and those are going to be explained in detail. We're talking about lowering health care costs. How do we do that? How do we look different from what you hear from Governor Walz? And then we know that we're going to do the tax conformity bill, and we know that we have to address things related to waste, fraud, and abuse. But with that, I'm going to turn it over to Senator Nelson to talk about some of the mental health issues.
Well, good morning. It's great to be here and great to see a new legislative session off to its start. As you know, untreated mental health concerns continue to grow in our society. And, you know, last year we did pass some significant mental health providing services and ways to help treat some of those issues early on. Unfortunately, many of those were vetoed. One of the ones particularly that I believe you'll see right out of the gate again is safe and secure schools. As you know, one of the issues is that some of our students, in fact, I will just tell you, in visiting with teachers across the district, as amazing to me, the counselor said the number one concern of their high school students was not what we thought, which would be making sure they were ready for college or career planning, but to a T, they all said the same thing. They said they were concerned about mental health. Their students' mental health was the number one concern of high school counselors that I spoke with. And so we're going to continue to push safe and secure schools that has a significant amount of mental health services early on for our kids. School-linked mental health grants can help prevent some of the tragedies that we see with untreated mental health. There's certainly more work to be done. We had passed the Cognito Suicide Prevention Grants. Of course, that was vetoed as well. And, of course, we championed those school-linked mental health grants. You'll see that come back again. And you might recall that we also passed some particular mental health support, extra support, for our farmers and our agricultural providers. And, unfortunately, that was vetoed as well. We know that that sector particularly is under some severe stress. And so we're going to focus on mental health. It's important to all of us. One in five people have some mental health that requires some treatment or care. We need to make sure that all Minnesotans have access to that. You can see that coming right away in safe and secure schools. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm Senator Bill Weber, and I chair the Senate Agriculture, Rural Development, and Housing Policy Committee. And of all the issues you've you have to deal with in that committee. Imagine our surprise when the last couple of years, one of the things that has come to the forefront is the difficult times that families in rural Minnesota have in finding child care for their children. You know, moms and dads that can't find child care can't work, and so eventually they either leave their jobs or they leave the communities altogether. And this past summer and fall, I was privileged to chair a working group of senators that traveled around the state of Minnesota and heard from many people, both family and daycare providers, about the issues that they face in their communities. And we visited different facilities. We heard the testimony of providers and the challenges that they face in conducting their businesses. And what we heard from them is pretty much consistent, no matter where you go in the state of Minnesota, and that is that government has made it nearly impossible to operate an in-home child care or private daycare center. The people who are doing it are doing it out of the love for children and for their families, and they can't bear to see those families suffer as a result of not having a place for those children. But they really are at the breaking point. And I think the other thing that became very apparent to us is that, you know, at the end of the day, the state of Minnesota, quite frankly, is the culprit in this situation. They have overly aggressive rules and regulations that are inconsistently enforced. There's a true disconnect between the Inspector General of Daycare, the only day Inspector General we have in the state of Minnesota, the department, and the providers and their inspectors. And finally, there has truly been demonstrated a lack of respect for these people that open their homes and their businesses to caring for one of our most precious elements of Minnesota, that being our children. And so we must say, hey, enough is enough. And I think the other comment that we heard in every place that we went is that if the state of Minnesota comes forward with universal pre-K for four-year-olds, you will destroy the rest of what's left of our daycare system. And these are really challenging times. These are really grave concerns for our daycare providers. And so as a result, Senator Housley is going to be leading a new committee, Family Care and Aging, and they're going to build upon some of the work that's already been done, putting together some bills to address these issues. And I know that some of the members that have served with me on this work group are coming forward with suggestions and bills of their own as well. But at this point in time, I would like to bring to the podium Senator Housley, who is going to be dealing with this issue and others.
Thank you, and I want to thank you, Senator Weber, for all of the work that you did over the last 6 months in dealing with this issue. As we put together the budget going forward, making sure affordable and accessible child care options are available for every family in Minnesota, and that's at the top of our list. As the new committee chair of the new committee, I'm Senator Karen Housley, chair of the Family Care and Aging Committee, and I look forward to hearing many of the proposals that will be coming before our committee this session. Last session, we heard powerful testimony from many Minnesotans affected by the child care crisis. Since 2010, Minnesota has lost almost 3,500 child care providers across the state, and more than 70% of these family child care providers have said that in the next 5 years, they're considering closing their business. And of those, 90% of them said it's because of the paperwork requirements and the increased regulation from the state of Minnesota. Those are significant factors, and those are something that we have to really work on in this committee. Minnesota families work really, really hard. They need affordable and accessible child care. My daughter and her husband, Jeremy, and their two kids, they're looking for child care right now, and she said, Mom, there's nothing out there. And she said, it's almost not worth it for me to go to work with the cost of child care and the distance that I have to drive, particularly in rural communities where there are no other options. We can do better, and that's why I'm going to be introducing the legislation to address affordable and accessible child care options. One, it includes funding for more child care startups and expansion grants. We funded child care development grants in the last budget, and it was a huge success. As a result, we had over 1,000 child care slots that have been created to date, and there's many more grants for this in this bill. Also, it increases the income level for child care tax credit. That'll be in the bill. It requires DHS to develop a plain language handbook for how to become a licensed family child care provider. Senator Weber, when he was doing his tour, heard this from many of the family child care providers, that they'd like one handbook on what the instructions are to become a child care provider. Also, it requires DHS to develop a uniform application for family child care providers in all the counties. And it also, there's another thing that Senator Weber and I were discussing, it requires DHS to establish an anonymous call-in line for providers to ask questions, because many of them are afraid to call in because they think as soon as they call in that they are going to be inspected right after. We're going to continue to look at many of these proposals to help make child care more affordable and accessible. We care about making things a little bit easier for Minnesota families. Affordable, accessible child care is something that is important to both families and communities, and I'm confident that we can get this done in a bipartisan way. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Michelle Benson. I chair the Health Human Services Finance and Policy Committee. Healthcare has been a conversation as long as I've been at the Capitol, and it's not going away. During the interim, our members were out listening to their constituents, working hard on new ideas for real-world solutions. Senator Dreheim and Senator Dr. Jensen in particular have been leaders in this area, and we will be coming forward with proposals that are really focused on the doctor-patient relationship. Can you contract with your primary care provider? Everyone knows that good primary care helps delay or even stop chronic illnesses so that we lower the cost of care. Do you have the right to shop for the best services available? Maine rolled out a proposal that we're going to bring forward and tested here in Minnesota that actually lowered the cost for consumers and engaged consumers in their healthcare choices. Really important that consumers, as they're making everyday choices in their healthcare, are looking for the best value. And we want to empower consumers to do that. And last year, we had several transparency proposals related to pharmaceuticals, and more pharmaceutical work is going to be coming this year as the cost of pharmaceuticals becomes a bigger and bigger portion of Minnesotans' healthcare costs. So those things that we passed last year and were vetoed will be coming back, but we'll have an expanded package of healthcare proposals that will be part of our solution, our recommendations for Minnesotans to have better contact with their doctors and more understanding of healthcare costs. So, thank you.
Well, good morning. We're back at it again. I'm Senator Jim Abler, chair of the Human Services Committee in the Senate. And we spend a lot of money in so many areas, and you want to make sure every penny goes where it's supposed to go. And historically, we have not always been successful at that. And so government is a good thing for us to serve in it, but it must be accountable and it must be effective. And frankly, a lot of people have had their faith shaken in government, and it makes it harder to get good things done, and that's really not what we're about. There's some examples of things you've heard about, the Department of Motor Vehicles, the whole Menlars thing, where literally $100 million has been spent in ways that made it worse. That you have heard about child care assistance fraud, where people just make up kids and they get the money. And seems like sometimes the overseers are slow to act upon that. That takes people's confidence away. On the elder abuse side, we trusted our agencies to look after grandma and grandma and watched as literally thousands of cases were put into the dumpster. And nobody wants that, but when we get to that point, it's time for us to act. And I could go on with more, but they said I only have 2 minutes, so I'm not going to get to do that. But this year, I'm optimistic with the hope of the new leadership in the governor's mansion and with the House and with the committed work of the people behind me and across the aisle. We can truly make a difference about this. The budget that we oversee in my niche is something like $15 billion a year. And if even 1% of that is wasted, that's $150 million. But it's more than that. And so as we decide where we're going to put our priorities, we have to make sure every penny is focused on the people who need it the most and the people who are the most challenged with their lives, so they could truly have the dream that what brings people to Minnesota. And so you'll see a number of bills working on making the systems tighter so it's harder to cheat and that the people who are honest and true in their work are actually rewarded for that and not given a lot of burdens that are unnecessary. And so a lot more to come, and I think I'm on time, so thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim. Morning. Equity, fairness, and common sense. Essentially, that's what we've been talking about here today with all these other proposals. And it especially makes sense when we talk about tax policy, exciting tax policy in the state of Minnesota. It's about making people's lives better and easier to live and choose and to pursue their dreams as they see fit. And we've been at that for quite some time, not just last year, but the year before that. Last year in the tax committee, we presented a bill to the governor, a bill that would have significantly improved the conditions for every Minnesotan in this state, each one of you in here and beyond these cameras. The governor vetoed that bill, and I'll leave my next comments off for now. But we didn't get anywhere with it, which was unfortunate. So we will continue our work this year to essentially, to put it simply, make people's lives better and easier. Now, I will mention, though, that some people have been talking about a gas tax increase. That will have the opposite effect on every Minnesotan. It'll make their lives more difficult and worse. It will increase costs across the board for everything for everyone. It is not what we need at this time. We don't need it. We can do better than that. So again, we will continue our efforts to bring equity, fairness, and common sense to the Minnesota tax system. And that simply means making people's lives better and easier for them to live and choose and pursue their dreams and get on with their lives. Thank you.
So before we take questions, you can see that we have a robust agenda in front of us. At this point, it's fairly general. That shouldn't be unusual for you guys to know. We will have the committee process now, and we begin to flesh out these committees and a whole bunch more of committees, but or a whole bunch more of issues. But as we look at this package, though, related to child care, mental health, health care costs, and making tax conformity one of the things that we need to get done. Those are issues that we hope reflect this statement. We want people to know that the Senate Republicans are people who care with ideas that work. And so when we talk about these issues, we're going to come forward with ideas related to them and concepts that actually work and will actually bring about change. And so that's what we want to be known for. So with that, we'll take questions for me or anybody else up here.
Can you tell us what the basic guideposts for tax conformity will be from your caucus?
I'll let Senator Chamberlain address that one.
Oh,
tax
conformity.
Basic guideposts.
I mean, I could, but I really don't.
I was chatting with my friend here. What was the question again?
What will the basic guideposts for tax conformity from your caucus be?
The principles will be equity, fairness, and common sense. What we had in the that's equity, fairness, and common sense for easier lives and better lives and easier for Minnesotans to live, choose, and dream. That's as general specific as I'm going to get, because there was stuff out there last year that's obvious, right? We had proposals in 17 and 18 in our bills, and it was obvious what we believe. And some of that stuff will be off the shelf, but as far as what we're going to do this year, that we'll leave those specifics as they are. But better lives and easier lives.
Mr. Chairman, will business tax reductions in some shape or form be part of that? Can we assume that? I mean, that's been on your agenda quite a bit.
We want to make people's lives better and easier, and we're going to bring equity and fairness and common sense of the system. And frankly, while I believe tax reform is important to the citizens of this state for a lot of reasons, I believe the issues that were listed 1 through 4, 1 through 5 are extremely important, extremely important. And I'm going to continue to work on my side of it with the group and the team and all these people behind me and those that aren't in the room, because it has to be done and it is important. But these other issues are extremely important to address, and we'll take those priorities.
Mr. Majority Leader, can you talk big picture? You talked about change. There's a lot of change you're going to deal with this year. New House, new governor. Good thing, bad thing? Tell us what you think. Is this a good reset?
So far we've had a number of meetings, myself with Representative Hortman, and the three of us also have met together with us two and Governor Walz, the three of us have met. I've also met with Governor Walz. And so there's been a number of meetings, a number of phone calls. And I'm optimistic about that. I mean, we have a fresh start. We have a governor that is now in office that feels like he'll be more pragmatic. I had a good working relationship with Governor Dayton, but it'll definitely be different. One of the things that I think will change, I think we all want it to change, we're all committed to it changing, is that the process is a little bit more transparent, that we figure out how to get to different parts of the process earlier, so that at the very, very end, the governor, myself, and the speaker have more time to work together with the committee chairs, with the commissioners, with every senator, and with people that really want to have input at the end. And if we do that, that'll be a significant change from the last number of decades back to what it used to be. And so that really is our commitment.
How about the message from the electorate? Democrats swept constitutional offices, took the House. Does that mean Republicans need to move towards Democrats?
No, I don't think so at all. We've had divided government most of the time in Minnesota. For some reason, they like that. If you look at what happens in presidential elections, it often affects what happens here. It was a normal midterm sweep, but we think our ideas matter and work, and we're going to prove it.
Senator Nelson, in the health care area, your caucus's stance on the provider tax and on the Minnesota care buy-in, would you mind encapsulating that for us, or Mr. Majority Leader as well?
Yeah, I'll take it first. You know, we passed legislation a number of years ago to remove the provider tax so that we could have a 2% reduction in health care costs. That is happening in the next couple of years, and so that is where we hope that it ends up. This is going to be an interesting process that we move forward with. But the provider tax has already been signed and meant to go away. And for it to not do that, we actually have to do legislation to do something different, which we're not really favorable towards.
So I guess just to add, obviously, I will not be in favor of increasing or bringing back that provider tax. It does just increase the cost of health care by 2%, and we work very hard to reduce that. So that is definitely something that would be damaging to all Minnesotans and to being able to get affordable, high-quality excess in health care.
And the Minnesota care buy-in high on Governor Walz's agenda and phasing towards single payer.
Well, I'm just concerned because of the low reimbursement rates and what that will do to access in especially our rural areas. I know the majority leader has more he'd like to say on that.
Thank you. So as far as the Minnesota care buy-in, it has to do with accessibility and affordability. Those are two things that we are going to be working on in the proposals that we bring forward. How do we make sure that there's access everywhere, and how do we control the costs? Minnesota care buy-in basically is government-run health care. In the end, that is a solution that will bring us to disaster. We will no longer have the market that we have. We will no longer have the services and high-class quality that we have in Minnesota. So we're very concerned about that. We don't support that. For Minnesota care buy-in to work, it means that hospitals will have to take reimbursement rates that they make no money on. So what will happen to the Mayo Clinic? What will happen to the rural providers? That's not the solution. But we do have to find solutions, and that's why we are going to roll out and put in our first five priority health care costs.
Leader Gazelka, could you describe the level of agreement you have right now with Speaker Hortman on resurrecting vetoed provisions from last session, and how quickly might those start going through the process?
So Representative Hortman and I met about a number of bills that got vetoed last year that had bipartisan agreement, and if the language is agreeable on both sides as is, because we have a new House with new leadership, and the chairs can agree, then there's no reason we wouldn't move some of those things forward. For example, some of the election money that comes through HAVA to make sure that we have safe elections, I think we both agree on. I hope that we move that sooner than later. And then there's a number of other issues in that omnibus bill that went at the end of the last year that got vetoed. But if our chairs agree, if we agree, then we're going to try to move some of those early. So we want to have some early wins. It's important, I think, for the process, for everybody to have some early wins. It's important for the governor to be signing bills so that as we move towards actually having a budget in the end that everybody has to sign and that we have to get done on time, we've built some momentum. So that's why we want some early wins for everyone.
elder abuse in that package yet, of things you can revive right away, or does it still need some more work?
So with elder abuse, there's been a bunch of work during the interim, and that's where we, if I'm willing to wait if we can get it even better. But there are some things within that that I'm willing to move forward if everyone agrees. That's going to be the key for the early bills. We want 100% agreement to move those kind of things forward. And that's one where there's been more discussion in the interim.
Senator, the provider tax is a source of money. It pays for things that I think you might support. How do you backfill the revenue that might otherwise had come from the provider tax? Is that a surplus issue? Is that general fund?
Well, and that's going to be the great discussion, one of the great discussions of this session. There's a number of things that are covered by the provider tax. It was meant to cover Minnesota care reimbursement, I believe, and that we have money coming from the federal government. But we're going to have to work on that with everyone. We believe it should go away. That's what the legislation that was passed years ago does, but we also know that there's some things in that we have to solve as a result of that.
One more question. Okay. On the federal shutdown, Governor Walz yesterday raised the possibility that one of those early bills might be some assistance for Minnesotans who are suffering the effects of the shutdown, workers who haven't gotten paid, other things. Have you discussed that? Can you give us a position?
No, at this point, we've had no discussion about the federal shutdown and what we should do about it. There's been a number of discussions about how do we navigate to not have a shutdown in Minnesota, which I believe we will not have because of the good dialogue that we've already started with the House and the governor. In Minnesota, I think we're gonna show that we can govern well, even in divided government.
Is that something you'd be open to, though?
I discuss any issue. I'll listen to any issue, but there'd have to be a lot more discussion related to that. So, last question for you, and then we're out of here.
You don't mind.
Yeah.
Senator Weber, you made a very interesting comment. You said universal pre-K will destroy what's left of daycare in Minnesota. Isn't that fundamentally the objective, is to replace it, or can you elaborate on that a little bit?
Well, no. The reality of it is that due to the rules and regulations that Minnesota has put in place, and I hesitate to refer to them in this manner, but quite frankly, the four-year-olds are the only profit center in a daycare operation. Due to the requirements as far as the quotas, as far as infants and toddlers are concerned, the only people that can produce any type of income for the facility is the four-year-olds and to some extent the three-year-olds. And so if we take them out of the equation, we've made what is already a bad situation even worse. And so that's what's behind my statement that I made earlier.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. This being the day designated in the Constitution and the laws of the state of Minnesota for the assembling of the legislature, I hereby call the Senate to order. Prayer will be offered by Chaplain Pastor Mike Smith from Redeeming Love Church in Maplewood, Minnesota. After the prayer, please remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance.
There's a button up here with my name on it, and it says Mike. And I forgot to push it. Welcome back. We've been looking forward to just all of us connecting together. But let's welcome the presence of God. Almighty God, you are full of grace and merciful. You are compassionate, unchanging, slow to anger. You're always abounding in love. And you've given us an invitation to come to you and just ask. You said to just ask and it will be given. Seek and you'll find, and knock and the door will be opened. Well, we come to you today and we do ask you for wisdom that's beyond our own knowledge. For we are already aware that in ourselves, we do not have solutions to the complex challenges that we might face. So we ask you for inner confidence and strength to endure. We ask that you would infuse this place with humility, which is the bedrock of unity. Fill this place with an honor for each other that is vital for community. Just as when Peter began to sink beneath the stormy waves of the Galilee, he cried out to Jesus and said, "Lord, save me." We also cry out to you, oh God, and we say, help us. Lord, save us. Sometimes the waves that we face, waves of adversity, can have names like fear and frustration or tension and even times of unforgiveness. But Psalm 62 says, when our hearts are overwhelmed, lead us to the rock that is higher than I. So, Lord, we depend upon you for wisdom, and we ask for courage to make right decisions and strength, recognizing that it comes from your presence. And we ask you for vision and dreams that would give us expectation for greater things. And Lord, with that in mind, we pray right now for our governor, Tim Walz, for our lieutenant governor, Peggy Flanagan, for Attorney General Keith Ellison, for Auditor Julie Blaha, and for Secretary of State Steve Simon. And Lord, we pray for our Senate Majority Leader Paul Gazelka, for Senator Minority Leader Tom Bach, for the House Majority Leader Melissa Hortman, and the Minority Leader Kurt Dowd. And we pray for all of our Supreme Court justices, people who are leading and making decisions in this place. And Lord, most of all, I pray and I declare blessing upon this great state of Minnesota. Lord, from the Lake of the Woods to Albert Lee Lake, from Red River to the St. Croix River, throughout Minnesota, we just declare and I declare, may your kingdom come and your will be done in Minnesota. Amen.
Please join me in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated.
It's all good. Thank you.
I hereby appoint Senator Julie Rosen as Clerk Pro Tem, who will call the roll by the legislative district in numerical order. When your district is called, please respond present.
First District, Mark Johnson. Second District, Paul J. Utke. Third District, Thomas M. Bach. Fourth District, Kent Egan. Fifth District, Justin D. Eichhorn. Sixth District, David J. Thomasoni. Seventh District, Eric Simonson. Eighth District, Bill Ingebrigtsen. Ninth District, Paul E. Gazelka. 10th District, Kerry Rood. 11th District, vacant. 12th District, Tori N. Westrum. 13th District, Jeff Howe. 14th District, Jerry Ralph. 15th District, Andrew Matthews. 16th District, Gary H. Dames. 17th District, Andrew R. Lang. 18th District, Scott J. Newman. 19th District, Nick A. Frentz. 20th District, Rich Dreheim. 21st District, Michael P. Goggin. 22nd District, Bill Weber. 23rd District, Julie A. Rosen, present. 24th District, John R. Jasinski. 25th District, David H. Senjum. 26th District, Carla J. Nelson. 27th District, Dan Sparks. 28th District, Jeremy R. Miller. 29th District, Bruce D. Anderson. 30th District, Mary Kiffmeyer. 31st District, Michelle R. Benson. 32nd District, Mark W. Coran. 33rd District, David J. Osmick. 34th District, Warren Limmer. 35th District, Jim Abler. 36th District, John H. Hoffman. 37th District, Jerry Newman. Newton, excuse me. 38th District, Roger C. Chamberlain. 39th District, Karen Housley. 40th District, Chris A. Eaton. 41st District, Carolyn Lane. 42nd District, Jason Isaacson. 43rd District, Charles W. Weger. 44th District, Paul T. Anderson. 45th District, Ann H. Rest. 46th District, Ron Latz. 47th District, Scott M. Jensen. 48th District, Steve A. Swadinsky. 49th District, Melissa Franson. 50th District, Melissa H. Wickland. 51st District, Jim Carlson. 52nd District, Matt D. Klein. 53rd District, Susan Kent. 54th District, Carla Bingham. 55th District, Eric R. Pratt. 56th District, Dan D. Hall. 57th District, Greg D. Clausen. 58th District, Matt Little. 59th District, Bobby Joe Champion. 60th District, Carrie Dietzick. 61st District, Scott Dibble. 62nd District, Jeff Hayden. 63rd District, Patricia Torres Ray. 64th District, Richard J. Cohen. 65th District, Sandra L. Pappas. 66th District, John Marty. 67th District, Fong Her.
A quorum is present. Without objection, Senator Torres Ray will be excused from today's session. The next order of business is the election of President of the Senate. Are there any nominations?
Madam Lieutenant Governor, I would like to nominate Jeremy R. Miller as our Senate President.
Senator Miller has been nominated. Are there any other nominations? Senator Bach. Are there any other nominations? Any other nominations? Nominations are closed. The clerk pro tem will call the roll in alphabetical orders. Members, please vote by saying the last name of the candidate.
Senator Abler.
Madam Vice President, Madam Lieutenant Governor, I'm sorry.
Thank you for the promotion, Senator.
Will we be doing any speeches on these?
Absolutely. Senator Sundrum.
Thank you, Madam Lieutenant Governor. Madam Lieutenant Governor and members, I'm proud to stand here today and to nominate for the 49th President of the Minnesota Senate, Jeremy R. Miller from Winona, Minnesota. Jeremy has served in this body since 2010. He is the husband of Janelle and the father of Drew, Luke, and Tom. By occupation, Senator Miller is a co-owner at a small business in Winona, not so small actually, the Miller Metal and Scrap Company, Winona, Minnesota, a fourth generation business that he and his brothers and his father operate on a day-to-day basis. Senator Miller has served as chair of the Jobs Committee in this Senate, has again been a member for now 8 years. We all know Senator Miller very well. I have never heard a member, frankly, even a staff member, speak ill of Senator Miller. He's a quality person. We all know that. Senator Miller looks forward to leading this body. He is a listener. We know that. Decisions on Senate rules will be made in a studied and fair fashion. Decisions on bill referrals will be made in a studied and correct fashion. Decisions on Senate decorum, custom, will be made appropriately and certainly fair. Senator Miller brings to us a spirit of collegiality and across-the-aisle relationships, I think, that we all appreciate and will appreciate going forward. Senator Miller is a friend of every member of this body, an outstanding member as well with respect to how he's regarded by our staff members. So members, Madam Lieutenant Governor, I'm proud to stand here today and to nominate Senator Jeremy R. Miller. He'll be an outstanding 49th president. I look forward to serving with him, and I proudly nominate him. Thank you.
Nominations are closed. The clerk pro tem will call the roll in alphabetical order. Members, please vote by saying the last name of the candidate.
Senator Abler. Abler votes Miller. Senator B. Anderson. Anderson B. votes Miller. Senator Anderson P. Anderson P. votes Miller. Senator Bach. Bach votes Rest. Senator Benson. Benson votes Miller. Senator Bingham. Bingham votes Rest. Senator Carlson. Carlson votes Rest. Chamberlain. Senator Chamberlain votes Miller. Senator Champion. Champion votes Rest. Senator Clausen. Clausen votes Rest. Senator Cohen. Senator Cohen votes Rest. Senator Swadinsky. Swadinsky votes Rest. Senator Dames. Dames votes Miller. Senator Dibble. Dibble votes Rest. Senator Dreheim. Dreheim votes Miller. Senator Dietzick. Dietzick votes Rest. Senator Eaton. Eaton votes Rest. Senator Eichhorn. Eichhorn votes Miller. Senator Eakin. Eakin votes Rest. Senator Franson. Senator Franson votes Rest. Senator Frentz. Frentz votes Rest. Senator Gazelka. Gazelka votes Miller. Senator Goggin. Goggin votes Miller. Senator Hall. Hall votes Miller. Senator Herr. Herr votes Rest. Senator Hayden. Hayden votes Rest. Senator Hoffman. Hoffman votes Rest. Senator Housley. Housley votes Miller. Senator Howe. Howe votes Miller. Senator Ingebrigtsen. Senator Ingebrigtsen votes Miller. Senator Isaacson. Isaacson votes Rest. Senator Jasinski. Jasinski votes Miller. Senator Jensen. Jensen votes Miller. Senator Johnson. Johnson votes Miller. Senator Kent. Kent votes Rest. Senator Kiffmeyer. Kiffmeyer votes Miller. Senator Klein. Klein votes Rest. Senator Curran. Curran votes Miller. Senator Lane. Lane votes rest. Senator Lane. Miller votes. Senator Lane votes Miller. Senator Latz. Latz votes rest. Senator Limmer. Limmer votes Miller. Senator Little. Little votes rest. Senator Marty. Marty votes rest. Senator Matthews. Matthews votes Miller. Senator Miller. Miller votes Miller. Senator Nelson. Nelson votes Miller. Senator Newman. Newman votes Miller. Senator Newton. Newton votes rest. Senator Osmick. Osmick votes Miller. Senator Pappas. Pappas votes rest. Senator Pratt. Pratt votes Miller. Senator Ralph. Ralph votes Miller. Senator Rest. Senator Rest votes Rest. Senator Rosen. Miller. Senator Rood. Rood votes Miller. Senator Sinjum. Sinjum votes Miller. Senator Simonson. Simonson votes Rest. Senator Sparks. Sparks votes Rest. Senator Thomasoni. Thomasoni votes Rest. Senator Torres Ray. Senator Uckey. Uckey votes Miller. Senator Weber. Weber votes Miller. Senator Westrom. Westrom votes Miller. Senator Wieger. Wieger votes Rest. Senator Wicklund. Wicklund votes Rest.
By a vote of 34 to 31, Senator Miller has been elected president. Senator Miller, please come forward and subscribe to the oath of office as administered by the Honorable G. Barry Anderson, Associate Justice of the Supreme Court.
Senator Miller, raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear to support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of Minnesota and to discharge faithfully your duties as President of the Minnesota Senate to the best of your judgment and ability, so help you God?
I do.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. First, I'd like to say thank you to all of you, my colleagues of the Minnesota Senate, for electing me as President of the Senate. This truly is an honor. Each one of us has a wonderful privilege to serve our constituents here in the Minnesota Senate, a privilege that very few Minnesotans have the opportunity to do. I'm so grateful to call all of you my colleagues and my friends. I'm also grateful for my family back home in Winona who allow me to serve here in the Senate, especially my beautiful wife Janelle and our three boys, Drew, Luke, and Tom. And I'm grateful for my constituents that I have the great honor of representing here in the Senate for trusting me to be their voice here at the Capitol. As I stand up here today, I can't help but think about a good friend, the late Senator Jim Metzen. Beginning with my very first day here in the Senate, Senator Metzen took me underneath his wings and really showed me and taught me the importance of being a good statesman and a good legislator. And knowing that Senator Metzen served as President of the Senate from 2003 to 2010 makes this even more special to me today. So with that, members, we will move on to the next order of business, election of officers. Senator Gazelka.
Thank you, Mr. President, and congratulations. I nominate that Cal R. Ludeman for Secretary of the Senate.
Cal R. Ludeman has been nominated. Are there any other nominations? Seeing no other nominations, the clerk will take the roll.
Senator Abler. Abler votes Ludeman. Senator Anderson B. Anderson B. votes Ludeman. Senator Anderson P. Anderson P. votes Ludeman. Senator Bach. Bach votes Ludeman. Senator Benson. Benson votes Ludeman. Senator Bingham. Bingham votes Ludeman. Senator Carlson. Carlson votes Ludeman. Senator Chamberlain. Chamberlain votes Ludeman. Senator Champion. Champion votes Ludeman. Senator Claussen. Claussen votes Ludeman. Senator Cohen. Cohen votes Ludeman. Senator Swedinsky. Swedinsky votes Ludeman. Senator Dames. Dames votes Ludeman. Senator Dibble. Dibble votes Ludeman. Senator Dreheim. Dreheim votes Ludeman. Senator Dietzick. Dietzick votes Ludeman. Senator Eaton. Eaton votes Ludeman. Senator Eichhorn. Eichhorn votes Ludeman. Senator Eakin. Eakin votes Ludeman. Senator Franzen. Franzen votes Ludeman. Senator Frentz. Frentz votes Ludeman. Senator Gazelka. Gazelka votes Ludeman. Senator Goggin. Goggin votes Ludeman. Senator Hall. Hall votes Ludeman. Senator Herr. Senator Herr votes Ludeman. Senator Hayden. Senator Hayden votes Ludeman. Senator Hoffman. Hoffman votes Ludeman. Senator Housley. Housley votes Ludeman. Senator Howe. Howe votes Ludeman. Senator Ingebrigtsen. Ingebrigtsen votes Ludeman. Senator Isaacson. Isaac votes Ludeman. Senator Jasinski. Jasinski votes Ludeman. Senator Jensen. Jensen votes Ludeman. Senator Johnson. Johnson votes Ludeman. Senator Kent. Kent votes Ludeman. Senator Kiffmeyer. Kiffmeyer votes Ludeman. Senator Klein. Klein votes Ludeman. Senator Curran. Curran votes Ludeman. Senator Lane. Lane votes Ludeman. Senator Lane. Lane votes Ludeman. Senator Latz. Latz votes Ludeman. Senator Limmer. Senator Limmer. Limmer votes Ludeman. Senator Little. Little votes Ludeman. Senator Marty. Marty votes Ludeman. Senator Matthews. Matthews votes Ludeman. Senator Miller.
Ludeman.
Miller votes Ludeman. Senator Nelson. Nelson votes Ludeman. Senator Newman. Newman votes Ludeman. Senator Newton. Newton votes Ludeman. Senator Osmick. Osmick votes Ludeman. Senator Pappas. Pappas votes Ludeman. Senator Pratt. Pratt votes Ludeman. Senator Rolfe. Senator Rolfe. Ralph votes Ludeman. Senator Rest. Rest votes Ludeman. Senator Rosen. Ludeman. Senator Rood. Senator Rood. Ludeman. Rood votes Ludeman. Senator Senjum. Senjum votes Ludeman. Senator Simonson. Simonson votes Ludeman. Senator Sparks. Sparks votes Ludeman. Senator Tomasoni. Tomasoni votes Ludeman. Senator Torres Ray. Senator Uckey. Uckey votes Ludeman. Senator Weber. Weber votes Ludeman. Senator Westrom. Westrom votes Ludeman. Senator Weaker. Weaker votes Ludeman. Senator Wicklund. Wicklund votes Ludeman.
Receiving 65 votes of the Senate, Cal R. Ludeman has been elected Secretary of the Senate. Mr. Ludeman, please come forward and subscribe to the oath as administered by the Honorable G. Barry Anderson.
Raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear to support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of Minnesota, and to discharge faithfully your duties as Secretary of the Minnesota Senate to the best of your judgment and ability, so help you God? Congratulations.
We will continue with the election of officers. Senator Gazelka.
Mr. President, I move that the election to other elected offices be made in one roll call unless there should be more than one nomination for any office.
Any discussion on that motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no. The motion prevails. Senator Limmer.
Thank you, Mr. President. I nominate Colleen J. Pacheco for First Assistant Secretary.
Colleen J. Pacheco has been nominated for First Assistant Secretary. Senator Rosen.
Thank you, Mr. President. And with great honor, I nominate Michael R. Lynn for Second Assistant Secretary.
Michael R. Lynn has been nominated for Second Assistant Secretary. Senator Senjum.
Thank you, Mr. President. I would like to nominate Melissa G. Mapes for Engrossing Secretary.
Melissa G. Mapes has been nominated for Engrossing Secretary. Senator Ingebrigtsen.
Mr. President, without hesitation, I nominate Sven K. Lindquist for Sergeant at Arms.
Sven K. Lindquist has been nominated for Sergeant at Arms. Senator Rood.
Thank you, Mr. President. It is an honor to nominate Marilyn Logan for Assistant Sergeant at Arms.
Marilyn Logan has been nominated for Assistant Sergeant at Arms. Senator Gazelka.
Thank you, Mr. President. I nominate Pastor Mike Smith for Chaplain.
Pastor Mike Smith has been nominated for Chaplain. Are there any other nominations? Seeing none, the nominations are closed. The Secretary will call the roll in alphabetical order. Members may vote for all of the officers by saying nominees.
Senator Abler. Abler votes nominees Anderson B. Anderson B votes nominees Anderson P. Anderson P votes nominees Bach. Bach votes nominees Benson. Benson votes nominees Bigham. Bigham votes nominees Carlson. Carlson votes nominees Chamberlain. Chamberlain votes nominees Champion. Champion votes nominees Clausen. Clausen votes nominees Cohen. Cohen votes nominees Swazinski. Swazinski votes nominees Dames. Dames votes nominees Dibble. Dibble votes nominees Dreheim. Dreheim votes nominees Dietzick. Dietzick votes nominees Eaton. Eaton votes nominees Eichhorn. Eichhorn votes nominees Eakin. Eakin votes nominees Franzen. Franzen votes nominees Friends. Friends votes nominees Gazelka. Gazelka votes nominees Goggin. Goggin votes nominees Hall. Hall votes nominees Herr. Herr votes nominees Hayden. Hayden votes nominees Hoffman. Hoffman votes nominees Housley. Housley votes nominees Howe. Howe votes nominees Ingebrigtsen. Ingebrigtsen votes nominees Isaacson. Isaacson votes nominees Jasinski. Jasinski votes nominees Jensen. Jensen votes nominees Johnson. Johnson votes nominees Kent. Kent votes nominees Kiffmeyer. Kiffmeyer votes nominees Klein. Klein votes nominees Curran. Curran votes nominees Lane. Lane votes nominees Lang. Lang votes nominees Latz. Latz votes nominees Limmer. Limmer votes nominees Little. Little votes nominees Marty.
Marty votes nominees Matthews. Matthews votes nominees Miller. Miller votes nominees Nelson. Nelson votes nominees Newman. Newman votes nominees Newton. Newton votes nominees Osmek. Osmek votes nominees Pappas. Pappas votes nominees Pratt. Pratt votes nominees Ralph. Ralph votes nominees Rest. Rest votes nominees Rosen. Rosen votes nominees Rood. Rood votes nominees Senjum. Senjum votes nominees Simonson. Simonson votes nominees Sparks. Sparks votes nominees Tomasoni. Tomasoni votes nominees Torres Ray. Utke. Utke votes nominees Weber. Weber votes nominees Westrom. Westrom votes nominees Uyghur. Uyghur votes nominees Wicklund. Wicklund votes nominees.
Receiving 65 votes of the Senate, the nominees are elected to their respective offices. Please come forward and subscribe to the oath as administered by the Honorable G. Barry Anderson.
Please raise your right hand. Do each of you solemnly swear to support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of Minnesota, and to discharge faithfully your duties as officers of the Minnesota Senate to the best of your judgment and ability, so help you God? Congratulations.
The next order of business is motions and resolutions. The Secretary will report Senate Resolution Number 1.
Senators Gazelka and Bach introduce Senate Resolution Number 1, a Senate resolution naming a majority leader and a minority leader.
Senator Gazelka.
Mr. President, I simply move for adoption of the resolution.
Any further discussion on Senate Resolution Number 1? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no. The motion prevails. The Secretary will report Senate Resolution Number 2.
Senators Gazelka and Bach introduce Senate Resolution Number 2, a Senate resolution relating to rules adopting temporary rules for the 91st session of the legislature.
Senator Gazelka.
Mr. President, members, this adopts the temporary rules. The only thing changes that were made is in this version are the update of committee names, but I want to say here that I've had questions from senators on both sides of the aisle saying, are we going to take a look at these? And I want to just say publicly that we want to have a subcommittee to look at the rules, both Senate rules and joint rules. So that's my commitment publicly that we ought to take another look at them.
Any further discussion on the resolution? This resolution does require a roll call, so the Secretary will take the roll. All senators having voted who have the desire to vote, the Secretary will close the roll. There being 65 ayes and 0 nays, the motion prevails. The Secretary will report Senate Concurrent Resolution Number 1.
Senators Gazelka and Bach introduce Senate Concurrent Resolution Number 1, a Senate Concurrent Resolution relating to the adoption of temporary joint rules.
Senator Gazelka.
Mr. President, member, this adopts the temporary joint rules from last session as the temporary joint rules for this biennium.
Is there any further discussion on the resolution? Seeing none, again, this resolution requires a roll call vote. The Secretary will take the roll. All senators having voted who have the desire to vote, the Secretary will close the roll. There being 65 ayes and no nays, the motion is adopted. The Secretary will report Senate Resolution Number 3.
Senators Gazelka and Bach introduce Senate Resolution Number 3, a resolution relating to standing committees.
Senator Gazelka.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members, this provides membership for the standing committees. I want to thank Senator Bach for communicating and trying to work with him on that. As you're aware, with Senator Lori becoming commissioner, there's some open slots there. Senator Bach and I will have a conversation about those after that election, February 5th.
Any further discussion? Senator Bach.
Well, thank you, Mr. President, and Senator Gazelka. Members, just moments ago, we voted on adoption of the rules of the Senate. And we adopted the rules from the previous biennium as the temporary rules for this biennium. And I just want to remind people what you just voted for in the rules. Rule 10.1 says, the majority and minority groups must each be represented on all standing committees of the Senate, substantially in proportion to their members in the Senate. Members, we have 34 Republicans in this body and 32 Democrats right now. But some of these committees are just way out of proportion with the rule. And I use judiciary, for example. My colleague, Senator Lott, sitting next to me, is the lead on that. There are 6 Republicans on that committee and 3 Democrats, a proportion of 2-1. 2 Republicans for every Democrat. That does not meet with not the intent of the rule. The rule doesn't say may or intend. It says shall be in proportion to the number of members in the Senate. So I think the Senator Gazelka, I appreciate that we made some headway on a couple of the committees closing that majority and getting closer to the 10.1 rule. But we're still afield in some areas of the committees meeting the rule. So with that, Mr. President and members, I'd like to ask for a roll call, and I would urge a no vote, and we come back with a resolution that meets the intent of the rules of the Senate that we just got through adopting.
Roll call has been requested, roll call granted. Any further discussion on Senate Resolution Number 3? Seeing none, the Secretary will take the roll. All senators having voted who have the desire to vote, there being 33 ayes and 32 nays, the motion passes. The motion is adopted. The resolution is adopted. Moving on to the next order of business, the Secretary will report Senate Resolution Number 4.
Senators Gazelka and Bach introduce Senate Resolution Number 4, a resolution relating to the schedule of standing committee meetings.
Senator Gazelka.
Thank you, Mr. President, members. This provides for the scheduling of the standing committees.
Any further discussion on Senate Resolution Number 4? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no. The motion prevails. The Secretary will report. Senate Secretary will take the roll. All senators having voted who have the desire to vote, the secretary will close the roll. There being 65 ayes and 0 nays, the resolution is adopted. The secretary will report Senate Resolution Number 5.
Senators Gazelka and Bach introduce Senate Resolution Number 5, a resolution naming a president pro tem.
Thank you, Mr. President. This names Senator Kiffmeyer, Mary Kiffmeyer, as the President Pro Tem of the Senate.
Any further discussion on the resolution? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no. The motion is adopted. The Secretary will report Senate Resolution Number 6.
Senators Gazelka and Bach introduce Senate Resolution Number 6, a resolution relating to the attendance of members of standing committees at meetings and seminars, providing for the payment of expenses.
Senator Gazelka.
Mr. President, this authorizes reimbursement for the attendance of members and staff at meetings and seminars on subjects within committee jurisdictions.
Any further discussion on the resolution? Seeing none, this resolution does require a roll call. The Secretary will take the roll. All senators having voted who have the desire to vote, the secretary will close the roll. There being 65 ayes and 0 nays, the motion is adopted. The secretary will report Senate Resolution Number 7.
Senators Gazelka and Bach introduce Senate Resolution Number 7, a resolution to notify the House of Representatives that the Senate is organized.
Senator Gazelka.
Mr. President, this requires the Secretary of the Senate to notify the House that the Senate is organized.
Any further discussion on the resolution? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say no. The resolution is adopted. Pursuant to the foregoing resolution, the Secretary will report Senate Resolution Number 8.
Senators Gazelka and Bach introduce Senate Resolution Number 8, a resolution relating to appointment of a committee to notify the governor the Senate is organized.
Senator Gazelka.
Mr. President, members, this requires the Senate President to appoint a committee of 8 members to notify the governor that the Senate is organized.
Any further discussion on the resolution? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed say no. The motion prevails. Pursuant to the foregoing resolution, I make the following appointments. Senators Bingham, Champion, Dietzick, Howe, Kiffmeyer, Curran, Rood, and Sparks. Moving on to the next order of business, announcements of Senate interest. Senator Tomasoni.
Congratulations, Mr. President, and thank you, Mr. President. Yesterday, my best friend and longtime legislative colleague, Tom Rukavina, passed away after a very long, courageous battle with leukemia. My heart goes out to his family, as Tom was a dad and a grandpa first. He left us all too soon, and I, like many, will forever miss him. Unlike many of us around here, who will not be remembered after we leave this place, Representative Rukavina left an indelible mark on the legislature and will be remembered for a long time to come. He was one of a kind, irreplaceable, and I doubt there will ever be another one like him. He served in the legislature for 26 years. NPR reported that he had been in the legislature for a quarter of a century. I told them that Tom would have corrected them by saying, it wasn't a quarter of a century, it was 26 years. He began his career in 1986 and retired in 2012. For 20 years, we went everywhere and did everything together. My family became his, and his family became mine. He has left a profound impact on my life, as well as the lives of many others. In fact, when he decided to retire, I was the first person that he told of his intent. I was sitting right there where Senator Kent is sitting, and he came down the center aisle and tapped me on the shoulder and beckoned me to that little phone booth there in the back. Well, we both squeezed into that phone booth, and we were in there, and I figured he had cooked up some last-minute scheme, even though we were both in the minority, and it was the end of the legislative session. So while we squeezed in there and closed the door, he tells me he's going to quit. I said, that's ridiculous, Tommy, you can't quit. And I started to walk out the door, and he grabbed me and pulled me back in and closed the door, and he said, no, I'm going to quit. But I'm not going to tell anyone until after we adjourn, so I don't have to give one of those goofy retirement speeches. Imagine that, one last chance to pontificate without any feedback, and he passed on it. Maybe that says something about him. You know, he could have been a senator had he chosen to run for the office, but he was housebroken. And he always said, if we gave you senators wigs and robes, you'd wear them. I told him I'd wear the wig. He was the most passionate individual I've ever met, and he made sure everyone knew. He was passionate about family, he was passionate about teachers, students, and education, both K-12 and college. He was passionate about anything Iron Range, whether it was mining, unions, jobs, immigration, ATVs, snowmobiles, hunting, fishing, and even sarmas, porchettas, and potizza. He was especially sensitive to seniors, as not only did he know all of them in his district by name, he had several in his own family. Incredibly, he was even more passionate about taconite taxes, Giants Ridge, Iron World, and the IRRRB, and I won't even go into that right here. Yet as passionate as he was about all these things, he was just as compassionate when it came to people who were not as well off, disabled, or disadvantaged, and who needed a bit of a help or a hand up. He was a giant in the fight for the little guy. He was a great human being. He was always prepared, very well educated, very articulate, and could be polished as well as brash. And he was the ultimate advocate for his district, and he earned your respect. People who knew him well loved him. And there was no doubt that he rubbed some people the wrong way, yet he often was able to get on the good side of many of those people. If he didn't yell at you, he probably didn't like you. He yelled at me a lot. He was funny, really witty, had a great sense of humor, and his humor was oftentimes self-deprecating humor. He was active right to the end, and as the letter to the editor that I handed out was written while he was in the hospital bed. It's very indicative of the man and his compassion, and even though he lost the ultimate battle, when he wrote the last paragraph in that letter, he had no intention of succumbing and was planning to be with us for a long time to come. So please join me in honoring my friend, our colleague, Tom Rukavina, in a moment of silence.
Members, please rise for a moment of silence. Thank you.
Rest in peace, my friend.
Senator Senjum.
Thank you, Mr. President. I, too, would like to honor someone today that served in this body. On December 28th, we lost the Honorable Bill Belanger of Bloomington, Minnesota. For those of you that didn't know Bill, Bill sat, Senator Franzen, in your seat. I happened to sit where Senator Laurie was sitting, and so we had a lot of opportunity to interchange. Bill served this body for 26 years. I would describe him as crusty, opinionated, freshman should be seen but never heard, and he was quick to offer his thoughts, no question about it. He was quick to tell others that they were talking too much. He was colorful, he was lovable. He would, every year, or frankly every year we had a tax bill on every occasion, vote for awful DFL tax bills just to get on that conference committee. He loved to do the conference committee. But in my life here, I will describe Bill Belanger as iconic. Again, if I didn't say it, he served 26 years, never in the majority. He never had an opportunity to personally hold a gavel. But he was a great senator, and members, in honor of Bill Belanger, I would request a moment of silence in his memory. Thank you.
Members, please rise for a brief moment of silence. Thank you. Senator Dibble.
Thank you, Mr. President, and publicly congratulations to you. I'm pleased to see you serve in that role. Members, I think most of you know that our family has had a bit of a rough winter, losing my mom just before Thanksgiving and losing my dad just before Christmas. But I just wanted to let you know I'm doing okay. And I'm doing well for a couple of reasons. Of course, I give thanks for having known the very fierce and intense love of our mother, and my father was our hero and our champion and was proud of all of us and told us so frequently, and we were able to be with both of them in the moment of their passing, and that was a blessing. But also because of the incredible kindness and love and support of everyone here. So I just wanted to rise and say thank you. You have really shown that this is a place full of loving and caring people. So to all of my colleagues, all of the staff, everyone who's reached out to me and my family, thank you very much.
Under announcements of Senate interest, Senator Dietzek.
Thank you, Mr. President, and congratulations. I, too, would like to echo what Scott said, Senator Dibble said. My father died right before Thanksgiving, and it was a shock to us. We weren't prepared for it. It was sudden, and it has been a rough month, but the kindness and kind words and thoughtfulness from all of you, including staff, and from many of my constituents and those in our neighborhood, I would like to publicly thank all of you on behalf of my family, because we would not have gotten through it without all of those kind words. So thank you very much.
Any other announcements? Senator Gazelka.
I don't know that I was planning on this, but I just think about we just honored a couple of longtime legislators with good reputations, and Senator Dibble and Senator Dietzek, you know, the passing of their loved ones, it just reminds us that life is precious, life is short, always shorter than we think it is. And I think about what we're doing here, and I come in optimistic. You know, we have a new governor, and I'm optimistic. I've met him a few times, and feels like he's pragmatic, feels like he knows that with divided government, you got to figure out how to navigate to the middle and get the things done that we all need to get done. And I'm optimistic about working with the new Speaker of the House. I didn't think it was going to be like it is, but it feels like she wants to do process and get things done earlier and be more open and transparent, which I think we all will benefit from. But as I think about when we are honoring people and that life is fragile, is we have an opportunity to make a mark here. Every one of us, we have an opportunity to do something significant for Minnesota. And most of us aren't even going to know what it is until we look back or until other people look back and see what we did. But the Senate has the opportunity to lead. I just feel like the traditions that we have here, Senator Bach, very passionate about the traditions. I am too. We've got traditions that really are about being statesmen and stateswomen and really doing what's best for Minnesota and leading. And so at 34-33, yes, I'm the majority leader, but 34-33 means I listen to every person every time. And even if we're 35-32, Tom, I'm going to listen to every person every time. But let's not waste this moment. Let's not waste this moment. Each one of us, we've got this, like this moment that we can make a mark. And so let's do it. Let's do it together. The things that we can get done together, let's do them. And the passions that you have individually for things that need to be done and take a lot of effort, don't give up on them. And members, with that, Mr. President, I move that the Senate do now adjourn until Thursday, January 10th at 9 a.m.
Senator Gazelka moves that the Senate do now adjourn until 9 a.m. on Thursday, January 10th, 2019. All those in favor say aye. Those opposed say no. The Senate is adjourned.